We're on, yeah. Good morning. Hi, I'm Sheila Davidson, and I am the very proud chair of the Madison Square Park Conservancy. And it's a pleasure to welcome all of you here today. Innovating Public Art is the Conservancy's fifth annual symposium addressing critical issues in the public art field. Each year, we've invited distinguished artists, thinkers, journalists, and cultural leaders to discuss pressing questions that impact the public, the exceptional artists whose work we commission, and other like organizations around the country. We began this program in a large conference room in 2015 with Examining Public Art. That was our first symposium, and we did this by inviting alumni artists who had realized projects in Madison Square Park to discuss the impact of an outdoor commission in New York City on their practice. Dreaming Public Art in 2016 allowed participants to imagine public art projects with no boundaries. In 2017, Accessing Public Art examined questions of how artists collaborate with organizations, municipalities, and neighborhoods to realize outdoor sculpture. Last year's Removing Public Art brought prominent participants to consider historic, controversial monuments and contemporary solutions. Today, we're pleased to partner again with the School of Visual Arts at this wonderful venue and to welcome our moderator, panelists, keynote conversation participants, and artists for what I know will be another significant morning to discuss ideas surrounding innovation in the public art realm. It's now my distinct honor to introduce Ron Pizzuti to you. Ron serves on Madison Square Park Conservancy's Board of Trustees. He's chair of our art committee, and he's the founder of the Pizzuti Collection of the Columbus Museum of Art. Please join me in welcoming Ron.
Thank you, Sheila. I'm a neighbor of Madison Square Park, and I am very devoted to the program of outdoor public art. Each year, I've seen the program grow in strength and creativity by the outstanding commission artists, some of whom are here today. I've seen the program grow in strength and create much impact to the community, to the neighborhood, the city, the national, and the international visitors who travel to the 6.2-acre park site. And this year was an especially proud one for the Conservancy, as we were commissioning an institution at the 2019 Biennale, and Martin Puryear is sitting here in the second row, with an exhibition by the revered American artist Martin Puryear, and our curator, Brooke Kamen Rappaport, serving as the United States Commissioner. When I walk in Madison Square Park with my family and friends and out-of-town guests, we're always inspired and challenged by the works of art on view. The summer's project, City in the Grass, by Leonardo Drew, is especially beautiful. Leonardo is here somewhere as well. Leonardo has created an outstanding carpet that sprawls across the oval lawn, inviting the public to sit, walk, or read or converse around the subtle hills and valleys in the sculpture. Congratulations to Leonardo Drew. So, I'm grateful that our program reaches audiences by presenting public art and by being at the forefront of issues that command the field. Public art is where some of the most powerful work in our time occurs. Madison Square Park Conservancy is a public-private partnership with the city through the Departments of Parks and Recreation. Jonathan Kuhn, Director of Arts and Antiquities of the Parks Department, is a special advocate for our program. It's now my pleasure to introduce him to you this morning with greetings from the city.
Thank you. Good to see you again. Wow, this is a big, good turnout on a wet morning. Yes, we've been welcome, and thank you. It's such a wonderful program you have in Madison Square. And also thanks to Keats Myers for leading Madison Square Conservancy. It's a park that's been transformed over the years. I represent the city and the city's Parks Department. Specifically, I'm here on behalf of the mayor and on behalf of Commissioner Mitchell Silver. And we've been programming art for 52 years. It's a little scary that I've been at Park for 32 of those years. And it's been a hallmark of our program since the outset that innovation is at the core of what we do. This is, after all, what artists are here placed in this world to urge us, to cause us to think deeply, to feel deeply, to look deeply, to innovate, to experiment, to challenge convention, and cause us to see our world in a more profound way. So we bridge that private imagination to the public realm, so-called, and it's not an easy bridge often, because I actually feel that innovation and truth to creative expression, it originates in the heart and mind of an individual. But of course, when you place it on view in public, how we connect to that public is essential, and we think that that's an equal responsibility that we have. We have about 5 curatorial programs in the park system, Madison Square being one of the premier ones. Of course, the Public Art Fund, Socrates Sculpture Park, I'd like to give a shout out to the Highline Curatorial Program, and First Street Green, a more up from the ground, kind of more recent innovation at East First Street. But beyond that, we're doing art all over the city. I'd like to acknowledge my 2 staff members. I think they're in this throng, Elizabeth Masella and Jennifer Lancis, who help connect all the communities across the city. I'm gonna just sort of very quickly tell you what's going on more broadly in the city. In 2014, when our new Parks Commissioner came into place, we felt we needed to, took us about 6 months to meet him, but when we did, he embraced what we do as sort of supporting his initiatives, which are in the role of urban planning and activation of public space. And we sort of crunched the numbers at that time. And we came up with this kind of pie chart, and that year being 2014, we did 49 projects around the city, but about 31 of them were in Manhattan. And we didn't like the look of that pie chart because it didn't really represent this city. I asked my staff the other day to look into what were the projects we did in the last year, 2018, and where did they happen. And we found out that we did 92 projects, nearly double, first of all, what we'd done 4 years earlier, but that more than half, 52 of them, were in the so-called outer boroughs. And so that equation had changed. And so the placement of art, to me, sort of represents another innovation that we're doing. It's really embracing this city in its totality. We also noticed that the numbers of who's making the art had sort of diversified extensively. More than 50% were by people of color, and more than 50% of the projects were conceived by women. This was a change certainly from 1967 when we started our program. So I think that a question I pose to the panelists who follow me today is, is innovation a means towards an end or an end and goal in and of itself? And for me, truth to one's artistic vision is perhaps at the core of, if you get there, then by whatever means possible, it's acceptable. But that really what I call sincerity of conviction or passion for the expression that you're trying to create and how you connect to the wider world. Take the personal and make it universal. So that's what we do. I want to turn it over now to Brooke Rappaport, and I'm pleased to introduce her. We met probably about 12 years ago on the board of Socrates Sculpture Park. She, of course, is the Milton Friedman Curator of Public Art at Madison Square and the Deputy Director at Madison Square Conservancy. She's been a freelance curator, curated 2 wonderful exhibits that I happened to see at the Jewish Museum on diverse subjects themselves, Harry Houdini and Louise Nevelson. I believe Leonardo Drew has an interest in Harry Houdini. I think he lives not far from his grave in Queens. She's a freelance writer, a lecturer, and most recently, as you heard, the U.S. Commissioner on the Venice Biennale, in which Martin Puryear's art was featured. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce my friend and colleague, Commissioner Brooke Rappaport.
Hi, everyone. Good morning. Thank you all for being here today. We are fortunate to have the generous support of the Emily Hall Tremaine Foundation for this symposium. Our thanks to Senior Program Director Heather Pontonio for her generous advocacy. I also want to recognize the wonderful Keats Meyer, Madison Square Park Conservancy's Executive Director, and thank you to Ron Pizzuti, Sheila Davidson, David Berliner, and to our colleagues Tessa Ferreros and Julia Friedman. They have worked with great expertise on the symposium today. Today we are considering how artists, organizations, institutions, communities, and neighborhoods bring innovative ideas, practice, and methods to put public art into the everyday. How outdoor sculpture can vitalize an artist's work, become a gateway to museum collections, gather people in communities or parks, neighborhoods or municipalities. I'd like to begin by recognizing the power and implications of works of permanent or temporary public art. Central to these innovations, despite the hold of our online lives, are the tenets of what is public art. Complete access, viewing work in an egalitarian context, and advancing varying perspectives. Historically, public space has been where people assemble to engage with one another, to generate thought, to be inspired or challenged, to commemorate heroism, victims of war, or to confront political issues. The fundamental responsibility of being a citizen can be proclaimed and complicated by works of art in the public realm. Today, works of art can be charged or endowed with the responsibility to confront the contentions of our era. Public work has become an unwritten contract between the artist and the citizenry to engage together in experience, sometimes glorious and sometimes agonizing. And we must heed artists' works for insight, reflection, power, even solutions. The public realm is a platform for the visionary work of exceptional artists. But have you ever heard of a public artist? When I read the obituary of the American historian Alan Brinkley, who died this week, he was lauded by a colleague as a singularly public kind of historian. And Kwame Anthony Appiah is called, with great respect, a public philosopher. And Zadie Smith is revered as a public intellectual. But public artist isn't a term for the ages. Instead, artists make public art. Contemporary public art's often complicated role may be because of enormous variations in the name of public art. There are permanent behemoths. There are works that take on new dimensions, not the landscape, but the airscape. There are projects that infiltrate the visual language of advertising and have become political action committees with national impact. Some works are temporary and disrupt cityscapes or summon the instability of an urban infrastructure. Some call out gentrification. Others are planned for permanence. And some works are called site-related, site-specific, or site-responsive. That term, site-specific, was first applied in the late 1960s, and it refers to an artist creating work for a particular location that disrupts or is integrated into its surroundings. The term is perhaps most famous for the deeply contested controversy surrounding the removal of Richard Serra's Tilted Arc from Federal Plaza in Lower Manhattan. The sculpture was removed 30 years ago in 1989 and caused upheaval in generations as to the very notion of permanence in outdoor sculpture. For many working today, the term and theory surrounding site specificity may be outmoded and in discord with constantly changing settings, lives, and centers that host public art. Perhaps our projects in Madison Square Park are a case in point. Josiah McElhenney's Prismatic Park embraced methods of social practice by bringing dancers, poets and musicians in the summer of 2017 into the community of the park. It's now installed at a Danish language residential college for international students who study art, architecture, and design. Diana Al-Hadid's Delirious Matter on view in the summer of 2018 has traveled to Nashville to a bucolic garden and museum setting. And the work in Arlene Sheckett's 2018 to 2019 Full Steam Ahead that was conceived for the northern section of Madison Square Park, surrounding and in the reflecting pool, that has found new settings in upstate New York and in Milwaukee. The range of public art encompasses social practice, like the 25-year-old Project Row Houses that began in 1994, and it can push out into the street from inside a building, such as Alex de Corte's Harvest Moon at the New Museum, or it can evolve from painting, as in Ferley Baez's work now on the High Line. Institutions like the Metropolitan Museum are planning to update an imposing facade with outdoor work. And Storm King, the venerable sculpture park, has added a program of temporary projects. And Martin Purrier's Swallowed Sun, Monstrance and Volute, conceived and constructed for the forecourt of the U.S. Pavilion at the 2019 Venice Biennale, took on American history in an outdoor work that considered and confronted American ideals in the neoclassical vocabulary of Monticello. All of this is public art. All of this points to expanding boundaries, to developments that continue to transform the field, that challenge studio practice, and that bring artists' work into close contact with people. There are responsibilities for institutions and for artists. There are opportunities for the public. This morning, distinguished artists, cultural leaders, and thinkers, our moderator, New York Times co-chief art critic Holland Cotter, and panelists, artists Ferley Baez and Alex de Corte, Max Hollein, director of the Metropolitan Museum, our conversation with Martin Purrier, Todd Williams, and Billy Chen, and presentations by Stefana Keen, chief curator of the Hirshhorn, and artists Abigail DeVille, Leonardo Drew, and Christina Iglesias. They will all discuss the issues surrounding how their practices or their organizations are considering reasons and significance for public art. We have an extraordinary group of participants today, and I'm grateful to them all for leading the conversation. It's my pleasure to welcome Holland Cotter and the panelists. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Holland. Welcome and happy summer solstice to everybody. I don't know if you saw the moon last night. It was fugitive behind the clouds, but it was major. And talk about public art. I just want to read a little something. I want to congratulate both Brooke and Martin Purrier for this incredible work that they've got in Venice right now. It's wonderful. You know, most people, you hear from year to year when people talk about the American Pavilion, the U.S. Pavilion, it's great, but dot, dot, dot. And this year, everybody I've talked with says the same thing. It's great, period. And I don't want to take up too much time here because we don't have so much time, but I wanted to mention how my own interest in innovative public art began. I arrived in New York in the early 1970s. I lived way downtown in the financial district in an old tenement on Greenwich Street, two blocks below the World Trade Center. It was a short walk from Battery Park and an even shorter walk from the many acres large empty lot along the Hudson River composed of landfill excavated from the World Trade Center. In 1978, Creative Time, a local nonprofit arts organization, began using the lot as a site for temporary experimental public art projects, calling the program Art on the Beach. The site was wonderful, a vast prairie of dirt, sand, weeds, and scrub grass, with views of the sky and water to the west and south, down to the Statue of Liberty, and east you had the New York City skyline. It was open year-round, around the clock, access was free, the audience was unusually diverse for that time. White and blue-collar workers from Wall Street, tourists, artists, and school groups. The art was multidisciplinary and often extraordinary. Choreographers, including Simone Forti and Charles Dennis, created dances for the site. Lower East Side punk bands came to play, so did Sun Ra and his solar orchestra. Alice Acock, Patsy Norville, and Nancy Rubens was very young at this time, they all were, in fact, made site-specific installations from construction materials that they found around the streets of Lower Manhattan. Because the city was financially a mess at that point, a lot of construction had stopped, so you had this stuff piling up on the sidewalk. It was great for artists. There were interactive sculptures by David Hammonds, Nancy Holt, and a young artist named Tom Finkelpearl, who is now our much-treasured New York City Commissioner of Cultural Affairs. All the installations were ephemeral, made for a season, so lots of artists, known and unknown, got to participate in the program. For me, the single most moving work was the one that would have been impossible, I think, to do any place else in Manhattan. Agnes Danis's Wheatfield, a confrontation. In the spring and summer of 1982, Danis plowed and seeded 2 acres of landfill and transformed what was essentially urban wasteland into a field of golden grain. You weren't in Manhattan anymore. You were in Kansas, maybe, or in Danis's rural Hungary, with the Twin Towers looming nearby like alien spacecraft. Danis conceived her piece as a political statement, a rebuke to the rapacious materialism that the Trade Center and the Financial District represented. Much of the work in Art on the Beach, though by no means all of it, was political, overtly or subtly. And new work kept appearing until 1986, when the construction on Battery City Park, a luxury apartment complex, went full steam ahead and buried the beach. I'm recalling all of this today, partly out of nostalgia, but also out of conviction. The conviction is that Art on the Beach can still serve as a model for creating a multidimensional, unpin-downable public experience of art outside of museums, galleries, and economically gated art districts. And that experience can be utopian, cheap, free, fun, ethically generous, and piercingly critical of the larger culture. By no means every work on the landfill was all of those things, but the experience of the project overall was. My guess is that the experience was as stimulating for the artists and curators who participated as it was for me. And I should say that experience for me was the absolute total opposite of my experience of the shed. Thanks. Max, take it up.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Holm. So, excuse me? Oh, you first. Okay.
I make work that encourages storytelling, more equitable storytelling. As a Dominican-born immigrant to the United States, I am particularly driven by the experience of navigating, articulating, and understanding spaces that are both familiar and physically distant. My research considers how individuals and cultures organize space, and how buildings and communities reflect and reinforce social relations conditioned by gender, race, and class. With a goal to reclaim power, my work presents fictional alternative universes with strong female protagonists who defy conventions of patriarchal narratives. My concerns with migration and our varied relationships with inherited cultural and regional histories can be traced back to my own upbringing in the border between Hispaniola's two neighboring countries. As a child of migration, my work has sought to better understand our present reality and self-perceptions, finding power in the place that I am from through situating stories of Afro-diasporic migration within an expanded discourse, placing them within a larger historical narrative and a wider set of inherited legacies spanning beyond those of this century. In doing this, my work seeks to untangle legacies of capitalism and imperialism while exposing the flawed nature of patriarchal macro-narratives, learning to position all of this from a voice of self-determination. My work acknowledges the reciprocal nature of migration as a nonlinear course of movement. The U.S. is deeply indebted to movements within the Caribbean, both movement comprising that of bodies and labor, and movement of ideas and minds. The U.S. would not be the U.S. without the Haitian Revolution. The Louisiana Purchase would not have taken place if that were the case. I seek to underscore streams of influence that are often overlooked or stifled by dominant and reductive understandings about migration that suggest a singular direction of transmission. Labels are of critical importance. And in many cases, well, we're back at Alex, was a bit too fast, here we are. In many cases, they are ascribed in accordance with colonial legacies of and positions of power. Who is an expat and who is an immigrant? Disenfranchised people are just as much a part of the histories that frame our current understandings of place, and that has to be acknowledged. How do we reaffirm and create room for specific bodies? In my work, culture and regional histories are cast into an imaginative realm where visual references drawn from the past are reconfigured to explore new possibilities for the future.
My name is Alex DeCorte, and I grew up in Venezuela. My father's from Caracas, Venezuela. And I remember when I moved back to the States, to New Jersey, there was a house, this house, in a town over from me, and it was painted purple. And I love the color purple. And I think about how color can incite change, and color can be an act of opposition. This purple house incited lots of mania and hysteria because the town had a code that was developed from a kind of colonial code that all the houses had to be these kind of variations of the color white. And for me, oh man. For me, the idea that color can cause change or cause conversation is something that has always informed how I think about the world. Art on the beach. This is Lucy the Elephant. It is one of the oldest roadside attractions in the States. It was made in 1881. And when I was thinking about what is public art, what kind of is worth putting in the world, I think it's strange. We live in this time where through platforms like Instagram or Facebook, there is this sense that all things are public and that what we do in private is also constantly dancing for camera. And a lot of that dance for camera is strictly to incite joy in times that are quite desperate. And I think Lucy the Elephant is a perfect example of that. Lucy the Elephant, sidebar, ran for president in the 2016 campaign, and she lost. This is an image from a film called It's a Mad, 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 Mad World.
again, nothing has changed. This is from, this is a great story about this man who drives off the side of the road and literally kicks the bucket and tells these travelers that there's a buried treasure somewhere in near LA under a large W. So all of these people lose their minds trying to find this public artwork. And I think that that's maybe something that public art can do or should do. This is a diner by my house that I would go to largely because I thought this was, there's this windmill, this kind of kinetic sculpture that's like a bad Calder or a great Calder. And I had to resist putting like a McDonald's Arches sign in here, but I think public art is everywhere. I miss Robert Venturi. And his partner, Denise Scott Brown, have constantly been thinking about how architecture can be the message of change. And here we have something that is maybe not the best, it's just a store, but to wrap it in flowers or to build walls in flowers is, for me, an act of being radical, especially when we're thinking about walls right now and walls that surround us, why not try to hope for the best? This is this beautiful work by Gene Davis leading up to the Philadelphia Museum, and again, color, my God. I included this image because this is Klaus Oldenburg's Kiss, and I really love that this is a response to the Brancusi work that's in the museum, but really what I wanted to talk about was this broken button sculpture that he made in Philadelphia, which is actually an enlarged button opposite the statue of Ben Franklin. And what has happened on the statue of Ben Franklin is that his belly is so big, the button is broken. And I think public art reacting to its surroundings is the way to be. And I'll end there. Boop, boop, boop.
Thank you. Thank you. My name is Max Hollein. I'm the director of the Metropolitan Museum. What I wanted to talk about with you is maybe give you three case studies from my experience about working with public art and as a curator of public art, and then kind of show you a little bit what we're doing at the Metropolitan in regard to that. So the first case study is I curated a large public art project in Salzburg in Austria. Salzburg is a very beautiful Baroque but conservative city, and we brought in a couple of artists to really make larger scale projects on major public squares. And so you had Aisha Erkman and then Paula Peavy put up this really helicopter upside down on the Residence Palace, and then Hans Schabus closed off the view into the Mirabell Garden in Salzburg, and so they obstructed the view of the great Baroque sculptures, everything that Salzburg kind of feels proud of, and a couple of other of these public projects. And while we installed them, the public media went extremely negative against it, and all the local politicians were against it, and I had to use my entire clout to really make sure that these public projects actually are going to happen. And then one artist who I've invited, Christoph Büchel, a Swiss artist, changed his project. And what he's then, different to what he wanted to do, he then actually organized a protest against the project. So with the money for his project, he basically paid for people demonstrating against the project. So you see Paula Peavy's work, and there you see Christoph Büchel's people protesting against it. And what he's done is he then created a referendum, meaning so he was collecting signatures, his people were collecting signatures to make a referendum against public art in Salzburg. So this was an art piece, but the signatures of the people were obviously real. And what he then triggered was a real referendum in Salzburg. So the politicians in Salzburg had to actually implement a referendum asking the citizens of Salzburg, do they really want public art in the city? And so the city was occupied with that for another year. Basically, there was an enormous debate about, do we really need public art in Salzburg? At the end of the day, maybe with a close margin, Salzburg citizens voted yes, we still support it. But I think this was an interesting, one of the most interesting public art projects as a reaction to the struggles of public art project that I've done. And it basically extended my curatorial role for another year, because obviously I had to kind of continuously support Christoph Büchel's project. He was long gone, but the mayor of Salzburg kept calling me what crazy artwork there is that he has to basically still fund. So that was one example. Another example is I was a director in Frankfurt of a couple of institutions, and when I traveled to Sao Paulo, I saw the really interesting graffiti scene in Sao Paulo. And I thought, okay, what if I use, so to say, our institutional ability to have these graffiti artists really legally use the main buildings in Frankfurt for their art. So very different to how they work actually in Sao Paulo, where they secretly, so to say, and overnight put up their graffiti art. So we managed to have these graffiti artists come from Sao Paulo and really do graffiti art on the most prominent buildings that the city can provide. So this is the police headquarters of Frankfurt, with graffiti artists from Sao Paulo obstructing it. This is one of the main churches of Frankfurt, where we invited a graffiti artist to do this. This is the main city square. And this is the headquarters of Deutsche Bank. So in a sense, what we wanted to test is, does public art of that kind, does graffiti art still work, even if it loses, so to say, the undercover agency that it sometimes had? And I think it really did. One other project that we've done was with Barbara Kruger for an exhibition that we've curated on. It was about art and consumer culture. And I wanted to have one public art work with that. So the CEO of this department store, which is kind of like the equivalent of, I would say, Neiman Marcus or Bloomingdale's or whatsoever, said, well, yes, great. Let me give you this one window on the left side where you can do something in regard to a public artwork. I said, no, we have something else in mind. And I showed him this work, and at the end, they paid for it. As you might see, if you can read German, it's a very critical artwork against shopping. It basically says, you want it, you buy it, you forget it. So it basically was, and it obstructed the entire building of this shopping center. The over CEO of this department store chain came to Frankfurt because he was very worried what was going on, and looked at this. In the meantime, all the media was reporting about this artwork. So when he then arrived, he asked me, well, can actually Barbara Kruger do this on all of our department stores in all over Germany? Because he was obviously very much looking for the PR effect of it. So it kind of, on the one hand, it was an enormously successful, massive public art project. But to a certain extent, it worked both ways. It was consumer critical. And on the other hand, the CEO of that department store chain thought, well, let's have it in all of our 72 department stores in all over Germany. So I think that to a certain extent, I really almost like to have this kind of almost like institutional power that I sometimes can provide, and then actually also stretch the boundary and push the envelope in regard to public art and that kind, and make really that happen for artists in such a way that they can really produce their most interesting work, as well as the dialogue that then happens with the public. So finally, about the Metropolitan, when we looked at the building, what we noticed, or what I didn't notice, is actually the Metropolitan Museum in its facade has, ever since the building got erected, 8 empty sculpture niches. The reason for that is that the museum ran out of money when it was building this building, so these were never filled. What we are now going to do is, every year we'll have a public sculpture commission for the facade of the Met, having artists fill these niches in the time between September to December of every year. So if you want to, maybe almost like, you know, the fourth plinth on Trafalgar Square on steroids, right? I mean, like it's like 8 times in that sense. So we've asked Wangechi Mutu, a Kenyan-born artist, to work with us on this first sculpture commission. And Vangetschi is currently here's some of our older sculptures, and to the right is a sketch for what she's planning to do at the Met, working with our own collection and then basically creating these almost like avatar sculptures, female custodians of the Met, which will then fill the sculpture niches. And then one other almost like public art project, but it's inside, is I really consider the Great Hall of the Met still almost like public space. Like 7.5 million visitors go through it every year. So what we are doing is we are commissioning artists to do a larger scale installations in the Great Hall. The first artist in that series will be Kent Monkman, and he will create basically a new series of larger scale history paintings of today for the Great Hall. Here's one example of his older work. And again, I'm very interested in basically having this work be not really publicly exposed, and basically probably in this case about 3.5 million visitors of the Met will go through the Great Hall and see this work in a very different context. Thank you.
Thank you. As Max has suggested, it can be difficult to maintain control over art once it's in the public realm. And I'm curious as to whether what you think, what has attracted you to working. I know, Fiorella, you do very, very close, very controlled, beautiful work. And what has prompted you to go into the public and bring that out?
I like the flexibility of a public space in the sense that people are open to destroy it, and I do like actively having room for people to react as they want. So the first sculpture I showed was a melding of two Sanssoucis. I showed images of the palace in North Haiti, but there's a Sanssouci in Berlin, which people are usually familiar with by the same name. And I wanted it to be a place where people could climb and graffiti it, or that was part of the stipulation of the piece, that if people reacted both positively or negatively, that was part of the work. So I like that edge of a public space, that people really can be pretty unpredictable in a way that in a museum space or in an exhibition space, you have a bit more control. But even within that, I try to build in some level of dissonance.
Alex, how about you?
In the few public interjections in the moments I have like participated in public work, I don't think of myself as a public maker.
Yeah.
But I like the idea that art is for everyone and can be accessible to anyone and should be. I think, like Fairley said, it's about the grit or the chance that it could be misinterpreted or lost or changed. I think letting go of the control of making is why you make something public. Mm. It's to let it set yourself free from this idea, maybe, of what you're working on.
Mm-hmm.
Because studio work can be, in some ways, all-consuming and kind of put you in a bit of a box. And I think to work and be engaged with the public is necessary.
Mm.
It just allows you to like keep growing. I think it's like deeply democratic and important and urgent. It's like it's necessary.
Mm-hmm. And Max, what inspired you to bring it out of the museum and sculpture and put it out front?
Well, I think if you're a museum curator or a museum director, you obviously like the challenge of it, and basically the challenge of making it happen, but actually also what public art kind of represents as an opportunity to be in dialogue with a much broader audience. But also it's almost like a competitive environment, as you see, because basically you have an audience there, but the audience is not really there in the first place for the piece, right? It's very different than if you go to the museum. So you want to make sure that you realize the work, but also that the work has the ability to enter into dialogue with an audience that's completely unprepared for it, and it can be either captivating, it can be beautiful, it can be challenging, but it's a very different and I think very invigorating environment. And I always thought of it also as something that where I can not only provide something as a curator, but really where you are really a facilitator in making it happen and protecting it and making sure it gets the working conditions for making a public artwork are so much more complicated and challenging. And I think it's also a question of being very, very organized to be able to do that. So I like that part of the process enormously.
Fairly, do you think, and Alex both, do you think that doing public work has somehow changed your work methods?
Definitely. I think there is, you have to externalize that. I can't make it on my own. So then I have to engage, and it has to be a conversation not just in the making, but in the reception of the work. When I feel like studio work can be esoteric, and it's usually shown in spaces where people are coming in with a certain level of visual literacy that's different. So you can perhaps make it more opaque. And all the work can be as opaque, but it's just a matter of being open to co-creating, I guess, is the thing outside of that space.
Mm-hmm. So your public art work is collaborative.
It becomes a negotiation with.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that a first for you?
I have done installations where it has been a collaboration before, but those were always in very controlled spaces.
Yeah.
So not very well-known institutions. So I always wanted it to be in a non-institutional space where I could probably know the audience a bit better, and it could be a conversation that we would all both know the codes of what were the symbols being given. Mm-hmm. And that's not always the case in larger institutional public work.
Mm-hmm. Alex.
I'm just thinking when we were talking last week and what Ryan Dennis was bringing up about destabilizing public art. Like, I think what I'm interested in relationship to public art is that public art always looks like public art. And so, like, how do we change our expectations of that? I mean, Christoph's work did that in that particular moment. You know, something gets graffitied. Like, how do you add humility, chance, slippage to something that is proposing to be so huge and monolithic? Like, that to me can be so boring. And so I think when I made the wah-wah for the new museum, my thought was, this is public, and it creates the anticipation that this chain store from Philadelphia called Wawa will be coming to New York, and so I got everyone's hopes up. But you'd finally have a good sandwich here, and then it didn't happen. And that's kind of, maybe for me, that's a more interesting way to interact with the public, that it's psychological, and that it isn't just about scale.
Mm-hmm. In that
or
sense,
spectacle.
Just a quick, I feel like that involves so much of nostalgia, and it might be unexpected, but someone who didn't come necessarily from that space, I guess we were both engaging in that storytelling where we're trying to make that personal universal, and that's something that I feel a lot of artists have been, like you mentioned, some of the ephemeral projects at the beach, have been already engaging with, and the monolithic work that we're so familiar with that became nostalgic for me, like the cube in Union Square, wasn't necessarily a narrative that I felt part of, but we made it part by inhabiting that space. And then taking artists like David Hammons, some of his or earlier performance work, having that be public interjected that, like what you were trying to say, that unexpectedness,
yeah,
without necessarily invoking nostalgia. Because I feel like nostalgia sometimes can be exclusive in that sense, mm-hmm, if you're not sharing that memory. Mm-hmm.
But everybody loves a sandwich.
Everybody does love a sandwich. But I have a public sandwich.
Right.
And you have a...
No, I couldn't agree more. I think this is a really important aspect of that. And I also feel that, I think what you said, Alex, is about, on your presentation, basically depending on how you define it. I mean, public art is everywhere, right? I mean, and it basically, I think to a certain extent, your work almost like refines a certain level of sensory about what we see and what we are being confronted with. And I mean, I don't know, a vendor of balloons on a beach has also a certain kind of visual appearance, right? And all sorts of different elements to that. So I think that there is a much stronger awareness, of course, about all the other things that are happening that are actually on the border of how you define actually public art, especially if you go into advertising and all these other elements. So this, on the one hand, this blurring of the lines, and on the other hand, this kind of added sensitivity that you bring to it, I think that's absolutely crucial. Mm-hmm.
And do you, when you're working, do you have an audience in mind?
I usually do. I feel like there are symbols that are important to me that I would like to become part of, taken from the marginalia to become the central narrative, to really shift the zeitgeist if possible, or in any way that's within my reach. But in the end, because they are sometimes encoded, that co-creating leaves it open. So I am making it for a specific audience, but I'm completely open to how they are opened by whoever comes to them.
Right. Yep. So you're not adjusting your work to an audience?
No, I think we are all filters, and irrespective of my intent, the work will change. Right. So even like the station in 163rd Street, they are histories and folk tales and narratives that are generative for Afro-diasporic people, like specifically from the Caribbean, but that's a constantly shifting neighborhood, and what they're going to bring to it, they might see, is completely different from what I intended, and I'm open to that.
Right. Alex, do you have anything to?
I would say that if I'm making work, it's specifically not for art people.
Yeah.
For people that are interested in art.
It's important.
That's completely important.
Right.
Not for any of you people.
Yeah. Let me just put a little add to that. Is there anything you think that public art should be doing, that it has a responsibility to do? Whether it's political, entertainment, is there anything like that that you bring to it?
Absolutely. It should be poking holes at all of these standards that have come before us that have been proven to be totally terrible. Mm. I mean, you're constantly doing that, you know, it's your main...
But that, I think, comes from opening what voices are centered or what voices are given room to speak. And that, luckily, is something that is changing. And the reason why we might have found certain work monolithic and boring was because only that same voice over different generations kept being reiterated. So, yeah, we poke holes when we, in the center, we poke those holes when we are given space to actually speak. Otherwise, we're constantly acting on that outside of whatever center space is there. I don't know, thinking of Calder and Henry Moore, how they became nostalgic to certain spaces, but not because they welcomed or reiterated who we were, but because we made it so. So, yeah, thank you for bringing in people from, you know, to do Brazilian graffiti in these other spaces. I think also of like Ibrahim Mahama, mm-hmm, his monumental sculpture is beautiful, but it's also so impactful. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Having you for those to speak.
Max, when you commissioned the sculpture for the facade of the Met, can you give some sense of what you're looking for or what you expect those what audience you're pointing that toward? An outside audience, well, an art audience?
I mean, of course, there are no specific expectations. I think on the one hand, it is clearly, I would say the first goal is we wanted to provide an opportunity. And if you you have the Met, you have the facade of the Met, you're sitting on Fifth Avenue, and you have a lot of people kind of going through the building, going into the building, or passing by. So I thought, okay, this is actually an interesting opportunity for artists in a way that this institution and actually this facade can provide it. Secondly, I thought, okay, these niches, if the museum would have had the money in the early 20th century, yes, they would have probably been filled with bronze sculptures of, I don't know, depicting Michelangelo, Dürer, whatsoever. Yeah? So you want to basically say, well, let's have a different practice about that, but reflect a little bit on the identity of the museum. And on the other hand, I think it's also about creating, yes, a different level of dialogue and maybe also transformation about what the institution can also be about. So I think that the outcome of this will be clearly some people will love it, some people will be negative about it, some might not even notice it, but it's something that really adds to the whole identity of the institution as well as to the experience of being part of the work. So, and then we are trying to select artists where we feel, okay, that they will have an interesting, it's an interesting proposal for them, but I think it really depends on the particular artistic practice, but how that really then transforms or how that materializes then into something. So it's really about providing, in this case really also, providing another, and I would say, interesting and an important opportunity for art.
Would you be open to having public performance? I feel like some of the best art, like, thinking of someone like E.J. Hill and those niches, he could do some fantastic work.
Yes, yeah, we would be, absolutely. I mean, to a certain extent, the Met has been doing that already with its Met Live Arts program, but yes, this would, so I would also argue that maybe the first iteration of this is almost like still like a classical, yes, like Wang Ichimoto will do sculpture, but I think you won't want to define it as basically, okay, this sculpture niche has to be filled with a bronze sculpture, right? You can deal with it in a very different way, and performance could be the next and very different answer to that, absolutely.
Wang Ichimoto certainly brings things to it that the facade probably has never had before, in terms of gender and identity, mm-hmm. very levels of identity, which is wonderful. Yeah. I want. Is there? Could you three name a single public sculpture that you feel has influenced you or moved you or revolted you? You know.
I can tell you one that's revolted.
Okay. Good.
I just was. I'm just thinking to myself that I can't believe we live in this country where there's still like Mount Rushmore. That's so funny to me. I mean, it's insane. end of story.
Okay.
Have you had a positive experience with public art? Just out of curiosity. I mean, I agree. Mount Rushmore is gross, but
yeah, I like the Alamo. I like that that cube that you were talking about. You know, that's like, it's really sweet watching people move that around. In Union Square.
Yes,
it's
yes.
It's totally
sure.
Loving, and people have a lot of joy.
Yeah,
that.
I agree. Yeah, I think interactive is neat. Mm-hmm. I like interactive, yeah.
I feel like some of the public art that I most love, I've never actually experienced. So like the Mandela public monument, mm-hmm. where you have to see it from different angles to even take it in. But I've never been to South Africa. So it just, I think I would love it. Mm. Or some of Christo's public works, a lot of land work. So I have traveling to do, but some of them are just not.
That's great. Traveling's the best. Yeah. Max.
Well, I love a lot of public art, and I would see if, I don't know, if one thinks about what were really works that. That opened up a whole new dimension, actually also for me, living back then in New York, I would say Felix Gonzalez Torres's billboards mm. were really something that really showed how you can bring public art, in a, well, how you can use, so to see, other platforms, use kind of different expectations, but really also communicate a very urgent and, but also very in a very poetic way, a very, very urgent and moving subject. So I thought that was one of the great moments, not only of his work, but actually also of public work. And then something that goes completely opposite is, I know not everyone loves that, but I think Jeff Koons's Puppy is one of the really interesting and very successful public artworks. And I remember when I was at that point working at the Guggenheim Museum, and when Puppy came up in front of the Guggenheim Museum Bilbao, this is this flower dog by Jeff Koons that he first showed parallel to Documenta. There was a terrorist attack on the puppy just before the opening. We found a bomb that was planted. It never went up, but so there was this kind of puppy that was really meant to be bring joy and beauty and just be a very positive thing. So again, there was an immediate, almost like negative reaction to it, but it survived it, and it ever since became this obviously symbol of just sheer beauty. There's a very different agenda, of course, encased in Puppy than with Felix Gonzalez Torres's billboards, but I really think it's a really beautiful piece.
There's a Gonzalez Torres billboard up now in Christopher Street mm-hmm. For the Pride that's been right. Put up in the corner there over the smoke shop. I'm just going to say my favorite sculpture, public sculpture. I'm from the Boston area, and I grew up near Walden Pond, and I love Thoreau a lot. Grew up with him when I was a kid. And if you go to Walden now, there's a pile of stones, a cairn of stones that was started in the 19th century. And has continued ever since. And the tradition is when you go to Walden, you put a stone on the pile, and that will guarantee that you'll return to that site. And so when I was a kid, I used to bike over there and put a stone every time on that pile, and the pile's still there. There was no signage on it when I was a kid. So you just had to sort of know it, that was what that was about. And but there's signage now. And so this interactive, commemorative, of this wonderful person who lived there, all that put together, it's my favorite.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, I love all those qualities of public art, actually. Mm-hmm. The interactive part of it and the commemorative part. And the fact that there are personalities involved with it, you know. That you're part of it. Mm-hmm. That's what I love.
Yes.
Yeah.
There's this, that reminded me of this, catacombs in L.A. where Marilyn Monroe is buried. And there's a tradition, I guess, where people kiss her catacomb, like the tomb. And from the many years that people have been kissing this tomb with red lipstick, the white marble has turned pink and it's bled to the other tombs around it. So there's this like pink kind of cloud around the whole thing. It's pretty wild.
And colorful, right? Color.
Well, it's not really. It's the color's kind of terrifying, but it's definitely an interesting public work for sure.
Yeah, I love it. Yeah, great. Should we go to some Q&As here? Would that be a good idea? If people have questions or answers, even better.
There's one.
Yes. One. And I think we've got some mics that are traveling around the.
Hi, good morning.
Hi.
I'm curious what you feel about the timeline of public art would be. So do you think that there's a window of how long public art should be in place in public? Do you think that after some sort of interaction in terms of vandalism or damage, that means that public art needs to be removed and that timeline is changed? And do you feel like there's an end user of public art in terms of if its outdoor portion is finished, does it go to an institution, or what do you think happens to the piece after its public portion is completed?
Mm-hmm. Anybody can pick up on that, Max?
Maybe I can. It's a very good and, of course, very complex question. I think that to a certain extent, I would say it's the the idea of permanency of public art, I think, is overrated. I think that you don't want to always have public artwork be there permanently. I think that that comes from an like old tradition of the great equestrian portraits of the Renaissance. They have to be there forever, whatever. And so I think that public art can really also be there for a certain time and create that. And actually, it's not about this kind of eternal manifestation of a dialogue or whatever, or something that you want to implement. Other things are of course great when you feel it's almost like something that you continue to go to. I think that there is a change for sure in the idea of how you actually respond to the work. Public artworks often work with this moment of surprise at the beginning, and something has changed. They transform a specific site. Obviously, that changes then over time, right? The preservation of public artwork is another clearly another issue. I always have this. I always had the attitude that on the one hand you want to be really respectful with the artwork, but I think on the other hand you have to. You want to do works where you understand it's in the public area. So and you create different responses. Not that you invite vandalism or whatsoever, but it still is the idea that this will be kept or is able to be kept in this in a similar pristine condition in a way that you could do it within a closed museum environment. I think it's almost like an impossibility, and it sometimes even destroys the idea of the artwork if you have a whole fence it off, guards, etc. And that basically means that yes, sometimes these artworks have only also a certain lifespan, and we should be able to deal with that. And then about your last part of your question, for sure, certain works have the ability to to work as a public artwork. Similarly work maybe also in an indoor or museum environment, but certainly not all of them. I mean, I think that they certainly then lose almost like one dimension of how they were initially being perceived. And I think some of it is then, it becomes a little bit of like a documentary, right? Of what the original actually intent was. I'm thinking more maybe like right now about. I mean, I would say right now we see often now the original advertisements of the Gorilla Girls, for example, right? And I think that's important that we see them in a museum context. But of course, it loses almost like some of the intention because it was really meant to be out there and communicated in a broader context. So sometimes you then actually deprive the work of that dimension when you bring it into a more closed environment.
Yeah, I agree. I saw all those first when they were plastered around Soho,
right,
back in the 70s and 80s, and that they really had impact then.
Right.
But now they're artifacts, you know, when you want to see them in the museum. Alex, do you have any sense of are you protective of your, physically protective of your
work? Oh, no.
No.
I think that change is good. I mean, I think that, you know, plastic surgery and restoring, you know, outdoor sculptures seems futile. Philadelphia has this really great tradition of making public murals. There's tons and tons and tons of them, for better or worse. And you know, they come and they go, and then they'll build a building next to one and then paint around it to adapt and then take the building down, and then all of a sudden there's this kind of quilt type of pattern that happens where you have an old mural and a new one abutting each other, and that's really beautiful. Mm-hmm. You know, for me, that's just like wrinkles. It's really, they're beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, I think that's, there's no need to resist that.
Yeah, I agree.
There is something, though, too. I guess we assume we have a collective memory through social media or through documentation. So some of the images that you're saying are losing power have been the only experience of that work.
Mm-hmm.
Like the Gorilla Girls, I've never seen them in person. The original installation, I've never seen them in person. But that hasn't really lost the impact of how they made room for me to mm-hmm. exist as an artist. So in that sense, I feel like that documentation, even if it's an ephemeral work that lasts for a short period of time. And even if it's not preserved, like you're saying, they're etched in our collective memory. And that, for me, is pretty beautiful. I'm thinking, too, of like sculptures like in Versailles. There have been some that have been graffitied with some racist graffiti in France, and the artists have chosen to just keep them to really reflect back, the culture of them in the moment. And so both the original intent and their graffitied work are part of what we remember and hopefully try to change.
Right.
Thanks, yeah.
And maybe something that one can add is that for sure, we've all now talked about almost like public art in physical spaces. But I would say that, of course, there's a vast area of, so to say, public art in the digital arena, right? So I think social media and all these other ways of distributing art, that's actually a vast, vast public space. And you see, so to say, art that happens there is almost like, by definition, public and not controllable in that context. So I think that there's another whole dimension to that.
It makes the case for public work to still be three-dimensional. Mm. You know, that's kind of like the interesting thing about being in the world is that there's a front
and
a back.
Okay.
You know, and in the digital world, although we can try to capture those things, we can't always experience that. So that's kind of a nice push against that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Are there other questions?
Just way back there.
Thank you. This was a really fascinating conversation. I wanted to sort of bring together some of the threads that I've heard. Power, color, and then the ability of public art to be sort of co-opted. And it's Pride Month. I'm thinking a lot about Stonewall, and I'm thinking about the sort of banality of painting a crosswalk in a gay neighborhood with rainbows. And I'm understanding that as a kind of like proof of political power over time, right? So as kind of evidence that that a community has arrived as a kind of political force. And I'm going back to what Firule is saying. I loved your show at James Cohan, by the way. It's really gorgeous. And Alex, your work is awesome. But I'm interested in how do you understand public art? Like, how does public art have the ability to build power as opposed to in the sort of like that crosswalk, just be evidence of kind of accrued political power. Does that question make sense? There's a lot there.
Yeah.
Like, how does it propose to not quarantine, but to free?
Right, so I'm understanding the rainbow crosswalk, right, as a kind of state-sanctioned, civic-led public art project to recognize a community that has, like, forced its way into political power. And I'm interested in Firule's idea that her work builds power, and I'm wondering how you understand, each of you, maybe, the sort of ability or what kind of form does public art take to build power as opposed to reflect the power that communities have already sort of created for themselves outside of the art world. Does that make more sense?
See, I mean, in your installation on 163rd Street, the ways in which it appears your symbols will come across may not be so evident at first. And so that someone might understand that message already on the train or beyond sort of frees up that message in the same way that maybe, you know, gay people are everywhere. So they're not going to stay in that crosswalk. And that seems like subversion comes everywhere. You know, it comes from the places that you least expect. And so I think constantly proposing that what you see is not always what you get is maybe one way to handle that.
I think there's, like when you were saying reflecting back what the status quo already is, like there's nothing more powerful than assuming a Henry Moore is and should be, you know, it's something that's already been there. So when you get to, I'm not sure, like that rainbow in a space where that position, the access of a certain gay community that is given here is not necessarily given in another continent. Like, if you can get to the point where maybe in reading that very accessible rainbow, there's a gateway to maybe creating a certain equity from that site to another, could be a place where it becomes more generative. So even though, I'm trying to think of how to even like open it up. Or granting access to that same symbol of power in other spaces, like in South Africa, there are, through social media, symbols that are given here that are, I'm sorry, I'm just like, can't articulate enough, but basically opening up symbols that are assumed to be given to other sites to give the equal access is something that can make something that seems dead and given power again, or make it generate power in a way that's not reflecting.
Any, do we have other questions?
Okay, this is going to be completely the opposite of that wonderful, beautiful question. Thank you so much for your thoughtful insights. I want to talk about the business of art and the process as a curator, an artist, to go through. If they're not commissioning your artwork, you know the artist, but the whole RFP process, and then money. And funding from the start and the end of the project, and kind of the challenges that you've come across, and how to really bring the art to fruition, this whole public art process. Thank you.
Oh. Yes, okay.
Sir. Yeah. Please.
I'm not sure how I can basically cover this whole thing. I would say that. First of all, I would say from an institutional perspective, or even as a curator, one has to acknowledge that working for an artist working in the public realm, and or even for a site-specific work, it's really a lot of work. And basically, there's a huge, so to say, investment in time. Often you need to convince people. You need to, as you said, you need to sometimes work with other people to make it happen, etc. So you want to make sure that when you commission it, basically, first of all, I would say, since you want to talk about the business of it, that the honorarium is really appropriate and really reflects that. And also that there is no idea of, well, that this work, we're doing it in public, but then it might actually end up in the market, so there's we are recouping that or something. It should really be just for the public area and the funding that needs to support that needs to make sure that you have an appropriate honorarium for that, as well as that you are able to really to produce the piece. And I think that's something that basically should be completely up to the institution to provide, and it's a matter of really professionally dealing with it and creating I would say a working environment where you can really do that. I need to refer back to some of the slides that I showed. On the one hand, I saw myself being the curator of some of these programs that I showed you. Yes, I had a very strong, I would say, curatorial voice in that, or by just selecting it. But then I mainly saw myself as a facilitator, and actually where I felt, well, because I know this particular city so well, or I have a certain reputation as a museum director in this city, I can get these things done. I can get these sites. I can make them available. I can help. So to see, I would say, if I would have been just a very, not really very, not unknown young curator, the Christoph Büchel project would have never happened. It would have been you would have. So you need to use, so to say, also your clout and then also your reputation to making it happen. That's part of the almost like the business as well
that you shield off the artist while working on it and making that really something that you can work in this much more complicated, of course, environment, for sure. It's like, and I have to say, as a son of an architect, I know how that works from experience, because some of that is fairly similar to doing a public architectural project in that context. I'm not, you probably had even more about the kind of funding scheme or something, but I don't really know how to best answer or what your question was about that, but I hope it at least answers some part of your question. Yeah.
Great, please.
Quickly, from the artist side, it's such a, especially with city public art, it's such a long negotiation. Something might be revealed 2 years after you were first invited to do that project. And in that meantime, you have to constantly fight for the person who's advocating for you to go further, especially on sites that have been neglected historically, to be like, okay, you're making room, make actual room, don't make a gesture. Mm. So going beyond your original invitation and then making sure that the imagery that you're depicting is not just palatable, but active, that it will generate some sort of reflection and room for belonging.
Absolutely.
Thank you. I think we've got to stop here and move on to the next section. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for being here, and especially a huge thanks to coming out in this really torrential downpour to join us for our symposium this year. I want to thank our panelists and Holland Cotter, our moderator, for that really wonderful, engaging, and thoughtful conversation. And I'd also like to take this moment to introduce our next speakers. So we're going to have it is my absolute honor to introduce Martin Puryear. He is the United States representative at the 2019 International Art Exhibition of the Venice Biennale, for which Madison Square Park Conservancy is the commissioning institution. He is going to be joined by Todd Williams and Billy Chen of Todd Williams and Billy Chen Architects here in New York City. They served as the exhibition designers for the U.S. Pavilion at the 2019 Venice Biennale. So I want to thank you again all for being here. We're just going to switch out their mics very quickly, and then they'll be joining us on stage for another conversation.
Okay, well, am I supposed to start now? Because I'm starting now. Okay. We're going to start, I think, with some images, and Martin, if that's comfortable with you, we'll speak to the images.
Yeah, I had a thought that I think we have a lot of images to go through, and I have a thought that it might almost make sense to describe what people can look at in advance.
Okay.
So, because I think when you talk as the images are going, I tend to want to explain a lot, and I think if we can say what the people are going to see beforehand, then we can just roll through it and then leave some room afterwards for talking about
Perfect.
It. But I just want to say that it was my pleasure to work with the two of you in Venice, and remembering back to that first visit at the U.S. Pavilion in Venice, and having a collective reaction to the space and to the legacy of the architectural imagery in that space, and also the issues with access to the space for everybody. I think we had almost universal, I mean, the reaction was shared. And so a lot of what happened in Venice is really a reaction to the pavilion itself and what it represents for our country and for the world. So, yeah.
We were there for you, and that was all. You know, so that's our pleasure was, I mean, our excitement was being able to work with Martin. I mean, we're just architects, and we want to make a place for life, and art is very important in our life, and your art is very important in our sense of where art is. So,
well, it was, I think, an extraordinary collaboration, because we solved problems in addition to providing a platform for the work to exist, and the whole process was a narrative, adapting to what we saw, and it was a constant state of adaptation and change and evolution, right up until the work got installed in Venice. We had to come up with an idea ended up being logistically and technically and from the point of view of engineering and structure was quite complicated, quite ambitious, and required changes at every step, at least for the main element that we put outside the pavilion. I'll say out front that one of the things we realized right away was the access to the pavilion, which you'll see in the photograph. Maybe that's going to be one of the first images.
Mm-hmm. But Martin, it's really your narrative that we were there for. And you're always working on your own narrative. And the narrative's not just your work, but it's the world outside and the world of history and the world of place. And so, I mean, actually, we were there to help to understand and develop your narrative. I don't think there's much more to it than that.
Well, you're reminding me of my first thought when I got to the pavilion is, and I'd been there once or twice before, was that this is a Jeffersonian set piece designed in 1930, an era when we're actually fully involved in modernism, but we hark back to a Palladian ideal architecturally in the design of a site to present American art to the world. And that was my strong reaction to that. And also more specifically, thinking about the rotunda where you first enter the pavilion. It's like a mini rotunda. And it just felt like that you were really entering inside of a sculpture. It's so small and so precious in a way. With a compass rose image sort of rendered in the floor with mosaic. And it's just so historical. And not exactly, well, here's an example of how unsuited it was for exhibiting the kind of work that's being done today, and maybe even in that time. We had to to get two of my works into the pavilion inside, we had to take out an enormous sheets of glass because the doors were too small. The doors are no wider than 57 inches, so we had to remove a great, with a lot of effort, we had to take out these big panes of glass and get the work in. Also, there was an issue with access in that every door to the pavilion, as you'll see in the photos, required three steps up into the pavilion level from the forecourt. And we all had a reaction to that. And this is where you came in, and we decided to try to raise the entire level of the forecourt and got permission to do that, to our surprise, and were able to actually put handicap access in a much more welcoming way than had been provided by the original design. I would say that, just speaking about public sculpture, public work, public art, I don't consider myself a public artist, and I feel like public art is to me a puzzle and a conundrum, putting work in the public realm. It just, for me, always makes me ask myself these really deep questions. What does it mean to put your work out into the public realm where the work is defenseless against how it's going to be interpreted and seen by the world? And it makes me think very hard about what it means, and that determines what I do. I'm a person who most naturally is an artisan working with his own hands or with the hands of a few trained people that I work with in my studio, making works that are not of a public art scale for the most part. So when I do take the work outside, when I do make work outside, and I've done, looking back on it, a fair number of things for somebody who doesn't consider himself a public artist, it's just, and what I'm going to show, what these slides will show, is the work that was done specifically for Venice, which was a rather ambitious construction given the time constraints and money constraints and every other kind of constraints that we had, which was a pretty ambitious outdoor project in front of the pavilion, and then the works which I had been working on in my studio for the past 2, 3, 4 years, maybe 5 years in some cases, which I sort of rushed to get completed in time to install in the pavilion. So you'll see both a public face of my work, but also the work that I consider quite private work that is in my studio with my own hands and without the idea that this would be put in a more public venue than a gallery and eventually in a collection someplace, either private or public. So
I wanted to just make one observation, which I think was interesting. I mean, I think as architects, what we really wanted to do, as Todd said, was to make this quiet for you, make this space quiet for you. And so raising that level created a kind of outdoor gallery, mm-hmm. and actually united the building so that it all became one. So it became such a conversation between you, your work, and the building. And to be quiet enough to make something better and make it feel like it's always been there and not like it's been imposed, I think is the small thing that we did. But what I wanted to say was, when we first started, remember you said, I don't want to put anything in that rotunda. And then we were talking about how can we block off the rotunda,
yeah.
so that you only go to the two galleries and you don't even know that the rotunda is there. And you just wanted to obliterate it. And we were saying, well, there's exiting, how do you get out? But then I think once we brought the terrace up together, mm-hmm. it really became a whole. And then the amazing piece that you installed in the rotunda, and it's powerful conversation with the rotunda, to me was a complete epiphany. So it was incredible. So I think to allow you to have a deeper conversation with the building and what that building means, and to see the results was just thrilling for us. So
I've generally hated that building. And I sort of hate the biennial. It's certainly the architecture one. We only really like the art one. And I've seen people abuse that building, as many people do, to simply say this is kind of a piece of trash. And it did seem that if, and you needed to have some sort of conversation with that building. So that was really the impetus behind how the thing evolved. We had a number of ideas that didn't work. For example, your idea of not using any but three spaces was tough.
Yeah.
I'm sure for Brooke and other people. We had an idea that we should roof that thing for a while. That was a terrible idea.
Bring all the art outside and not even go in the building.
Yeah. Yeah.
My first reaction was to basically cancel out the rotunda as an exhibition space. There were issues with emergency exit and egress that we had to consider. There were quite a few constraints that we were confronting. I think my first reaction was that I can't relate to the space. I can't relate to the history. I can't relate to what it represents. And I felt the rotunda especially was just this kind of mini, it was almost like you're inside of a sculpture. It's this mini celebration of something Palladian. The irony is that Jefferson had been influenced by Andrea Palladio, who worked in and around Venice and had these amazing estates or country seats that he would design for wealthy noblemen and wealthy people in Italy at the time. And we were actually able to visit after the opening of the Biennale. We actually visited for the first time some of his places outside of Venice, which were so inspirational for Thomas Jefferson as he was designing Monticello. So I eventually came around to using the rotunda as an idea, and it kind of generated the piece that got constructed for the one of the two pieces that were constructed specifically for the biennial exhibition. Most of the works in the biennial were works that I had been working on for years, as I said, but the works that were made specifically after I had been notified that I'd been selected, were two works. One is the big screen outside, which I called Swallowed Sun, and the piece inside the rotunda, which was made, which I called Column for Sally Hemings. And Sally Hemings, as many of you know, is the slave owned by Jefferson, who was the mother of, I think, his last four or five children. And they had a relationship that had been contested by Jeffersonian scholars for many, many years. And finally, DNA evidence has made it fairly clear that he was, in fact, the father of Sally Hemings' children. So she's somebody who has been living in the shadows of history, and this was a chance to put her in the center of this entire Jeffersonian folly, you might say. Oh.
So I've been given the finger warning that we should move on to slides.
Okay.
Not the flag warning yet. So we're starting here.
Uh-huh. Oh, okay, yeah. So there we go. Well, this is one of the few pieces I've done, which is, not few, but one of the examples I've done of actually truly public work. This was Paris, 1999, in the Chapelle de Saint-Louis-Salpêtrière. It's a cathedral which hosts an annual autumn festival. And this was a temporary work I made for the cathedral called This Mortal Coil. The building was like the U.S. Pavilion in Venice. It's a sort of landmark building. You can't penetrate. You can't do anything to alter the building in any permanent way. So this entire structure had to be gently attached to the building, stabilized and it was done with steel cables. But it is in fact a spiral staircase up to the up to the heights of the building, goes up 80 feet inside the building. Starts out very massive with massive wooden timbers and structure, and it gradually gets lighter and more ethereal as it rises. It's about 80 feet at the very top. Another work which is the previous work was temporary. It was kind of like what Madison Square Park does. Work rotates at intervals. And that was up for all of 6 weeks, I believe, in Paris. Very extraordinary degree of planning and engineering to make it possible, but had a very short lifespan. This is permanent. This is at the Getty Museum, Getty Center in Los Angeles. And it's a stainless steel work. Stainless steel and bronze. It's about 45 feet tall. And I don't know what I can say about that. It's just there.
I'll give you another one.
Another work that is permanent. This is in Washington, D.C. in bronze. And not cast bronze, which is normally how an artist works with that material. This is, in fact, closer to the way that I work, which is more additive, which is more constructed rather than molded or modeled. This is made from sheets of bronze that are hammered into shape and attached to an interior armature. It's a work called Bearing Witness. It's about 40 feet tall, and it's in front of the Woodrow Wilson Center for International Studies in Washington, D.C. It's a permanent work. This is a work which is made of thatch, straw, water reed straw, in a sculpture park in southern Sweden. It's called Meditation in a Beechwood, and it's built over a timber frame. And I guess it's evidence of how I like to engage something about the locality. In this part of southern Sweden and northern Denmark, there's a fair amount of historic architecture, historic farmhouses that are still being maintained as thatch roof structures. And I was very drawn by the kind of shapes that this thick layer of roofing material produces. And so I used that material working together with a very, very skilled professional thatcher to design an armature that would support the thatch as a covering and as a way to produce the shape. And it's a work that is, I would say, semi-permanent in that the material itself, the covering material, the thatch, the water reed, is an organic material and needs to be replaced at intervals. And it's had at least one, and I think it's gone through its second replacement now since 99. This is a work which is maybe familiar to you. This is the work that was at Madison Square Park a few blocks away, and it's called Big Bling. And it's again, this is 40 feet tall, gilded shackle, surmounted on a open work structure. This work was made, I have to say that I'm actually an artisan, and I tend to be very involved in how things are made. And so this is an extension of how I work in the studio, using wood, and being very, very involved with the structure. And it started out as a small maquette, and we had to find an industrial fabricator who could make the glue laminated timbers and do all of the construction detailing. This, in some ways, presages what I ended up doing in Venice. We used the same fabricators, industrial-scale fabricators. And this is the Venice Pavilion. This is the work which is called Swallowed Sun. from the outside as you approach the pavilion. Blue lamb timbers, this is the pavilion as it originally appeared. You see the steps to the left and right going into each door, and then the middle door, the central door, which takes you into the rotunda. And we're moving pretty fast here, but you can see on the left, there's a ramp that takes you up to the level of the forecourt, original forecourt level. It's only curb height, but still you have to have this rather unattractive checker plate surfaced ramp for wheelchair users. This was, I think, on our first visit in January. First visit was July. Right. Second visit was January. We're all bundled up there. And so
we're going to zoom through these. So
can you go back, Billy?
Todd, look at 9 minutes and 25 seconds.
I just want to talk about this piece of crap. I mean, I climbed up on the roof there, and I nearly fell off the roof because I saw that dark parapet at the top was basically totally unstable. And but all we were trying to do is to try to make this accessible and usable. And the Guggenheim owns it, and they didn't take very good care of it. And so we thought, okay, maybe we can leave the building in better shape and provide a platform for Martin. So that was our assignment. And so what was interesting... Go ahead.
I'm the timekeeper, and I'm watching
like
that time
image.
Click
okay,
down.
Go ahead.
Right. We're just... So...
Okay, done.
That's as it was.
Yep.
We formed a ramp and stairs and had a lot of discussion with Martin about that ramp and stairs, raised the platform.
Well, the tree needed to live, so
we had a tree pit.
Yep.
And that gave a space for the beginning. Really, actually, what Todd was trying to say, and I'm going to say very fast, is that we thought we could attach to the parapet, couldn't because it wasn't strong enough. So then Martin decided to hold up the whole thing himself.
Yeah. So we decided that we had to make some kind of arrangement to support this screen, which I had come up with, which was in a sense a graphic representation in two dimensions of the idea of an oculus in the middle of a dome ceiling. And so this was projecting that idea onto a flat plane. But how do you hold that up? By the time we had engineered it and figured out how big and massive it had to be to withstand, it ended up being so much heavier and more massive than I had imagined it in my feeble mind. And this is it under construction in the fabric, in the factory in Unadilla, New York, City, New York, where it's made from glue laminated timbers, massive construction with galvanized connectors. And I decided that we should try to support it with something like a flying buttress, which was this under construction here. It's essentially a crescent-shaped I-beam, which the engineer was dictating how strong and heavy it had to be, which was completely shocking to me. But we ended up building it, and this is how it ended up looking finally in the pavilion inside. That's what you'll see when you go inside. If we can go back a couple of slides or a couple of pictures, there's an image which shows what.
Oops, Todd, here. You,
back to this. That back to the image of the ramp.
Ramp. Forward ramp.
Yeah, and right after that one.
One. There
you can see there. Right behind the screen, this is the ramp that we put in for the handicapped users. And that ramp and the stairs on the other side are what allow immediate access to the forecourt level. And once you reach the forecourt level at the new raised level, it went up 20 inches from the original brick floor, then you can just walk right into any of the three doors in the pavilion, which was a game changer, complete game changer. And
Well, kind of a cool thing, by the way, is that the window was always level with that long window that we had to remove or had to be removed to move Martin's work in. was a step up, or a large step up, from the courtyard. Therefore, it was divorced, and now that window in the courtyard makes the courtyard a single gallery. The columns also sat on their own clunky bases, so the columns, in a way, become part of the, I guess, sculptural ensemble. That would be up to you, Martin. But what is amazing, with if you read Holland Carter's article and some of Brooks' writing, is the discussion, not with the individual works and the entire discussion as one moves through it. Mm-hmm. And that's really what it's all about. Martin doesn't talk, he always talks about how things are made, but it actually is the work itself that is the most fascinating thing, and the relationship of the work to the place. So I needed to say that, sorry.
And here, this is the beginning of the views into the works that were installed in the gallery, eight works that were installed in the gallery that mostly hadn't been shown before. The red piece had been shown before, and everything else in the interior galleries were newly exhibited. On the left, you see the column for Sally Hemings, which was carved wood with an iron stake with a shackle, surmounted by a shackle on the top, driven into the top, and placed right in the center of the compass rose design on the floor, mosaic on the floor.
Well, it columns the compass rose, which is interesting, and seems to be a perfect base for this column, which is, in a way, talking to the columns outside, and then through the cleaning the interior of the building, you begin to have relationships that you never had before.
Well, it's interesting in talking, you know, using the word subversion. In such a quiet and powerful way, it was a subversion of the compass rose, because from the compass rose rose the column. And in a way, it also echoes the way the columns were abstracted outside, because they no longer sat on the pedestal, but they were just columns coming down from the ground. So I love that discussion, Martin, that you had with what was existing and then how to change it into something new.
Well, it was a shift of a mind shift from completely wanting to reject that rotunda to finally letting the rotunda give me a direction, and then also finally accepting it as a place for something appropriate to happen that felt right.
Yeah, really feels right.
Yeah.
Seems like all of the work is one thing inside another, at least to me. And again, calming those galleries, which are not, so in a way, it's kind of the opposite of what some of the earlier things we're discussing, because as you say, you're primarily working inside. This is a wonderful image to me, when we're inside this gallery, with these two pieces looking out into the...
Yeah, it's two sides of the coin of my work, which is the side of the maker, the person who makes more or less intimate things, and then the other side of it, which is work that is made to interface directly with the public at scale, more like an architectural scale, or a scale that can hold its own against the open outdoor space. Those are the two sides.
Well, the other thing, I haven't walked, haven't seen all of the works we can walk through, but I also love the fact that you almost could not escape looking at and walking inside this piece, because you basically enter underneath that buttress. I mean, it was weird that you described it as a buttress, because it's quite unlikely buttress. I was thinking, you said you needed to buttress that thing, so I was thinking, oh, we need to attach it to the building.
Yeah, and that was our first thought.
Yeah.
And you climbed up there and you said, this building is not going to take anything. It's not going to support anything leaning against it. It can't support, hardly can support itself.
Yes.
Not to mention a massive vertical plane that's going to be. So, but it did require some pretty serious engineering. So.
Now we have our 46 seconds left. And I'm not sure what the next step is, because I didn't read the run of show. What?
10 minutes of Q&A.
Oh, 10 minutes of Q&A.
Okay.
Hi, Thanks. It seems like the architectural interventions that you had to do were very much a part of the work. So does that mean you have to remove them when the show closes?
Apparently we do. But is that going to happen? I mean, it's not well enough built that it should stay. That bothers me.
I have heard that, is it Richard Armstrong from the Guggenheim Foundation?
Yeah.
Who actually likes what has happened there, and he has, at least verbally, was reported to me that he hopes it can stay.
Oh, cool.
That's what I've heard.
But it needs to be redone.
Yeah, but there is this person, Chiara, the Italian contact, who is kind of the custodian of the Guggenheim Pavilion, the U.S. Pavilion there, who warned us in advance that we would be given, if we were given permission, the conditions for that permission would be that it would be removed after the Biennale. So those are the two things.
Actually, that also is interesting, because we not only had to protect the tree, but the brickwork below, and make sure that it drained through that platform. Mm-hmm. So there were interesting little challenges, or big challenges, to make sure that it didn't interfere with the work very much. Right.
Since the Phrygian cap was the only older piece that you specifically brought in, I wonder what the motive, obviously related to liberty, but what were the other motivations for choosing that particular work? I found it said, going there, it was a very strong statement right at the beginning.
What were motivations for my including that piece?
Of all your earlier works, why that was the only one brought in?
I think because the image, some of the imagery, and there were three images in the exhibition that were suggestive of headgear. In fact, four, if you include the antlers. And it just felt like, since it was really about the image of freedom that had been, that really goes back in time. I mean, right in Venice, in the Accademia Museum, there's a sculpture, marbles, actually, maybe, I'm not sure if it's marble or plaster, but there is a sculpture of Canova, I think, or a copy of a sculpture by Canova of a man wearing a Phrygian cap. So it just felt appropriate. I mean, what's interesting to me is how these connections from our time through that building's architecture, through Palladio, through Jefferson, and here we are in Venice again, which gave rise to so much of the imagery of the pavilion itself, the Veneto, the Palladio's buildings in that area, which were kind of sort of manifestations of a very, very rarefied sense of the neoclassical. He mastered that. And so it felt appropriate to include it. I did want to have new work in the Biennale, but that seemed like one piece that was appropriate to drag in and include with everything else. Does that answer your question?
First, I just wanted to say thank you for the work that you do and for providing the space for so many artists to follow behind you. And second, I wanted to just talk to you about that space, and that, you know, your work so clearly provides space for people to use poetics and politics together to make objects that engage society. And, you know, you're a bit younger than my father, who fought in World War II, and a lot of the people like him, they became auto body mechanics and straightened out cars. But you got the opportunity to actually make creative work. So I wondered if you could discuss how that kind of, I know it's a bit long question, but discuss how that poetics and politics and being in the world as an artist, kind of that push and pull and that experience.
I don't know if I could say a whole lot about that, because that's why I make work, and that's what the work is. So I'm not the greatest person trying to describe. I mean, I say look at the work. But the challenge is, and I think for me at the present moment, the challenge is to be living in times that one is preoccupied with the fate of so much of the values that we are trying to keep alive. They're really under siege right now. And how do you somehow engage with that sense of, I almost want to say, citizenship, being part of a society, and feeling deeply for the society and for the welfare of society. But how do you engage that, not lose hope, and remain an artist? And that's the challenge.
Hello, thank you for that wonderful presentation. I haven't yet seen the Biennale, but that has been a very vexed building for a great many years. And it's good to see it revised in such a wonderful way. But it does give rise to the question of whether if your sculpture doesn't remain there, what is its possibility for an afterlife somewhere else? Because it is so strong that it seems to me that it could have an afterlife. And I felt the same way about the piece in Paris, and there have been other pieces in those programs that have been moved never to be seen again. Conversely, did travel the world for a while. So I guess my question is, it leads to what do we save of what we value, which you've been talking about politically. I think this is both an artistic and political crossing.
I think that's what you said raises a lot of issues, but was that a question?
Yes.
Okay.
The question was, do you feel that it can live apart from the building?
That is a question, and I can say that for the piece that was in Madison Square Park that was shown earlier, the piece that was titled Big Bling, that had a second life in Philadelphia. It was a very different piece in Philadelphia than it was in New York, where it was conceived and where I think it really was about dense urban life. The work was about dense urban life and striving and so forth. And it will probably have a third life in Mass MoCA in North Adams, Massachusetts, if we can find a spot for it. The work in Paris, I'm told, has been put in storage, but it's so specific to its structural requirements that I don't know how it could be placed anywhere else. As I said, it wasn't allowed to be supported in any other way than gravity, by resting on the cornices in the building. We didn't drill a single hole, we didn't do any single, so it's very specific as to how that piece could ever be removed and placed someplace else. But I was told it was put in storage and it could be reinstalled in its original location. As for the work in Venice, we are looking for ways to bring it to the United States and hope that it will find a venue here. All three of these works, Big Bling, the Swallowed Sun in Venice, and the piece in Paris, are not what I would call permanent works in that the materials of them, they're very well made and long-lasting. lasting, but they just, they're not pieces that are meant to be around two or three centuries later. They will have a life, they'll have a lifespan of possibly 20, maybe 30 years, and after that, they probably need to be recycled.
So, just saw the double flag, which I think means that we're at an end, correct? What, any final word, Martin?
I'm grateful for the chance to have represented my country, and also it, I have to say that it was a challenge because I think I'm representing the United States at a very, for me, very troubled time, and to engage the hope and the reality of the moment we're living in and remain an artist, as I said, that's the challenge. And it's a challenge for all of us, is to find our better natures and to keep that alive. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to Martin, Billy, and Todd for that wonderful conversation. It is my pleasure to introduce our next speakers. First, we'll have Stefana Keen. He's the chief curator at the Hirshhorn Museum and Sculpture Garden in Washington, D.C., followed by Abigail DeVille, an artist based here in New York City. And then we'll have Brooklyn-based artist Leonardo Drew, whose exhibition, City in the Grass, is currently on view at Madison Square Park, so we please welcome you to go and see that as well. And then Cristina Iglesias, an artist who is joining us all the way from Madrid. More information for each of our speakers can be found on the back of your printed programs. Thank you.
Oh, sorry. To the slides. This one? Okay, that's good. Hello, good morning. Well, it's an honor to be here. I want to thank Brooke for inviting me. It's an honor to be here. I'm a little bit blinded by this slide, but with such distinguished artists and colleagues, such a pleasure to see my good friend Kent Monkman also being invited to the Met. I've worked with him on a few occasions in the past, and he's truly a great artist. So I thought that I could lead you into a bit of the institutional thinking that has led us at the Hirshhorn into a major renovation of the garden project. As some of you may have read through the press, we announced it recently. Hiroshi Sugimoto has been commissioned to redesign our garden. And I'm sort of happy to report that the Commission of Fine Arts unanimously approved the project a few weeks ago, and the NCPC, the National Capital Commission, Planning Commission, also unanimously approved. So we're on a good track. Now we have to find the money. Well, I know this is not the crowd to do this. So I can only share some images of the project that we have. Here is one, and some of you, those of you who are familiar with the Hirshhorn garden will see a few changes. The pool is not the same as it is now. One can see also walls on the left side, which is the east side of the garden, on the capital side of the garden. And also to the right, a more single-leveled and also open field. And from the mall, a direct access onto a larger platform that from which you have a view on the Hirshhorn, on the museum, and on the garden, actually, which is not the case now. You have to, you know, go down a few set of stairs, and so from the mall, currently, you don't have that view. The other key aspect is the tunnel. as you can see, that leads back to the Hirschhorn that was the original plan. Three major thoughts sort of guided us into this project. One is that, just to give you simple numbers, we can average 30 million visitors on the mall every year that go up and down and visit the various museums, and only 150,000 visitors made it down to the garden last year, which is half of 1%. Now, don't get me wrong, we don't want 10%. we don't want 3.5 million or 3 million visitors. We could not accommodate it. It would be terrible for the art. But if only a little more, that would make sense. The other thought that we had in mind was reestablishing the connectivity or the connection between the garden and the Hirschhorn as it is now. Well, from a view or a viewing standpoint, when you're on the mall, you can't really understand the connection between the garden and the Hirschhorn, but also originally there was a tunnel leading under Jefferson from where the Liechtenstein has been standing for years to the garden directly. So that was closed at some point, and there is no actual connection, physical connection between the garden and the Hirschhorn, as there is no real, I mean, viable connection between the Hirschhorn, between the mall and the garden. And the third part of our thinking is quite simple. Art has changed. Felicia mentioned Calder and Henry Moore. So we do have a lot of Calders and Henry Moores, and we do intend to keep them. But as public sculpture, and we've seen it this morning, has evolved in so many ways, and we need to assess this in some form of manner. And the way the garden exists right now does not allow us to fully embrace these changes within the art world. I'll just run through, I thought I'd run you through the various transformations of the garden and then highlight a few features of the project. So that was the original plan. Believe it or not, this was approved by Congress in 1967. There was a reflecting pool, that went all along across the mall. Bunshaft designed it for Skidmore, Owens, Merrill. And actually, they started construction in 67. They dug ground until some protests and some voices said, this can't be, we can't interrupt the perfect stream of the mall that leads from the Washington Monument to the Capitol by this sunken garden that would be also of modern art. So there was quite a bit of resistance for modern art sculpture, sunken modern art sculpture, to block the flow of the mall. So this was changed into what is now, which is still the only garden actually on the mall, the National Gallery one, National Gallery's garden across the mall. It sits between Madison and Constitution, so it's not proper on the National Mall. Ours is. It is still sunken. It's even sunken even deeper. The original plan, I think, was 10 feet. This one is 14 feet. And Bunshaft's original design, well, second design, the one that was constructed, was very much inspired by his travel to Japan in the early 60s with Noguchi. And by the I'd say not the the fashion, but the influence that Japanese garden models had on American architects and modernist architecture in those years. It was brutal. The Washington summer is awful. It's terribly hot, and this was not a very friendly place to be in the summer. There was no shade, you had to walk on pebbles, there was no accessibility ramp, and so very shortly after its opening, still a beautiful thing. I mean, if it could happen again, talk about preservation of historic sites, this is truly the model that we would want to reestablish one day, but not in Washington. Hiroshi Noguchi and Bunshaft in Kyoto. Truly the model of the original Bunshaft Hirshhorn Garden. And then landscape architect Lester Collins was called in to modify the garden, to add some shades, to add some grass, so vegetation, and also to replace the pebbles by concrete aggregate pavements, which echoed the concrete aggregate that Bunshaft had used for the perimeter walls. It turned out to be, and also accessibility ramps, which was an issue. So it turned out to be a great addition to the garden. Bunshaft approved the plan, and it also led the way to some form of curated presentation of the works, because of the planters and their acreage, or the way they were bordered by little stepped ledges of concrete aggregate, you could sort of make groupings of works. The quick look at how the tunnel evolved. There was a tunnel leading from the Hirshhorn Plaza to the garden. You are certainly familiar with Washington's troubled years in the 80s and 90s, but it became a very unsafe place. And so it was closed down, and we opened an art lab, which is an educational lab for teens to learn new technologies. And so it was just shut down. So now the major, one of the major innovations that we seek to realize is the reopening of that space. So here is again the key part to reconnect the building to the garden and the mall, and a view of the tunnel. And the other innovation that Sugimoto is adding. So the tunnel will be, it's quite a beautiful design. It's sheets of metal, actually, that are formed in a never-ending curve that leads to the center of the Hirshhorn building, the actual center of the circles. And it's very open and very luminous. And stone walls that are inspired by Japanese stone wall masonry that will be at want of the proper word, but enclosing the garden, and also forming sort of exhibition galleries within the garden. So here is Sugimoto showing examples of this. The key concept behind the tunnel, so a work that he realized at Otima in Tokyo, sort of an endless cone that will lead to the center of the building. And I think the fundamental part of our thinking is the art. So we have moved into performance. Last year we had a piece by Tino Segal. We're having Meredith Monk very soon. We've been doing a number of programming in this field. We also, just to lead you more to the slides and stick to it, on the right side, you have the East Garden Modern Sculpture Collection. So part of our thinking is we have Rodins, we have the Henry Moores, the Chadwicks, the Hepworth, and others, and we want to enclose them or create spaces in which we can properly put them together. In the center is a reflecting pool and performance area, and to the left is an open field where we intend to have projects on a yearly basis. These can be pavilions, these can be single artist programs or projects. So now we're considering the number of possible artists that we want to invite. And around, we will be placing different types of art that are more contemporary than what we have now on 7th Avenue, on the East Apron, and on the West Apron. I think I'm over by, this red light thing is flashing, I have a notice, so that's all for this morning. Thank you.
Hi, good morning. It is my pleasure to be here and share with you this morning. I was really overambitious with my slides, so I'm gonna just plow through them. But first I'd like to read a statement, which is something that I think about that's central to making work as an artist, but the responsibility of making work in now, 2019. And it's from James Baldwin's The Creative Process in 1962. The dangers of being an American artist are not greater than those of being an artist anywhere else in the world, but they are very particular. These dangers are produced by our history. They rest on the fact that in order to conquer this continent, the particular aloneness of which I speak, the aloneness in which one discovers that life is tragic and therefore unutterably beautiful, cannot be permitted. And that this prohibition is typical of all emerging nations will be proved, I have no doubt, in many ways during the next 50 years. This continent is now conquered, but our habits and our fears remain. And in the same way that to become a social human being, one modifies and suppresses, and ultimately, without great courage, lies to oneself about all one's interior, uncharted chaos, so have we as a nation modified or suppressed and lied about all the darker forces in our history. We know in the case of the person that whoever cannot tell himself the truth about his past is trapped in it, is immobilized in the prison of his undiscovered self. This is also true of nations. We know how a person in such a paralysis is unable to assess either his weaknesses or his strengths, and how frequently indeed he mistakes the one for the other. And this I think we do. We are the strongest nation in the Western world, but this is not for the reasons that we think. It is because we have an opportunity that no other nation has in moving beyond the old world concepts of race and class and caste to create finally what we must have had in mind when we first began speaking of the new world. But the price of this is a long look backward, when we came, and an unflinching assessment of the record. For an artist, the record of that journey is most clearly revealed in the personalities of the people the journey produced. Societies never know it, but the war of an artist with his society is a lover's war, and he does at his best what lovers do, which is to reveal the beloved to himself, and with that revelation to make freedom real. So thinking about interior and an uncharted chaos and looking backward, all of my work is dealing with thinking about black holes as a concept or a space for historical erasure. And I work doing collaborations with a theater director named Charlotte Brathwaite, and also sometimes doing costume design and mainly specifically site-specific installations where I'm commissioned to make something on that site, usually that has to do with the troubled history of the location of where I've been invited. So these are actually set designs that I did for the Midsummer Night's Dream, directed by Peter Sellers at the Stratford Ontario Festival in 2014. And I made a Event Horizon happening for the actors on stage, and the audience actually sat underneath a sea of debris. So I locally scavenged for materials by the site and then tried to pick on a particular fact or unknown history about that location, and trying to tell whoever happens upon that particular sculpture or work information that they might not know with their own materials. So this in particular is called Harlem River Blues. It's a site-specific installation I did near the base of the Willis Avenue Bridge, which is not technically where the African-American burial ground is in Harlem. There's an African-American burial ground that was a cemetery in the 19th century that was bulldozed over, where there was also cemeteries adjacent to it where white people were buried, and they were exhumed and bodies reinterred in the North Bronx somewhere, and then these bodies just got kind of mixed in with the soil. So for a long time, there was an MTA bus depot on top of the site, which I think in 2016, there's a New York Times article where they started excavating because of some persistent church ladies who knew that the bodies were still there, and they dug maybe about 5 feet before they hit a human skull. So the bodies are actually still there. So thinking about collecting materials and then making something that could reclaim the space of the lost kind of fragments of history, and the lost history, or the history that were the invisible histories that are present in all of the spaces that we occupy. This is called The New Migration. So the first public art project I did was for the 5x5 Commission in DC in 2014. And the Phillips Collection has a portion of Jacob Lawrence's Migration series. And so when I saw those there and looking around for sites where I would be interested in proposing a project, I came to Anacostia, and it was one of the only neighborhoods that we went to where I felt a connection with the people there, felt like a community. All of the places that they kept taking us to had been recently bulldozed over with new glass constructions on top of, and you could tell that the populations of people had just been pushed out of these areas. Everything was very glass and new. And thinking and being inspired by the Great Migration, and thinking about the path of continual migrations that happen for people looking for opportunities of just space to breathe and live, and thinking about the things that people take with them, whether that's embedded within your DNA, and thinking about how we're walking around with 500 years of information embedded within our genome, so that our ancestors are always walking with us. But thinking about the actual material things that they took with them, and the things that got left behind, and the fragments that we're left with as people kind of, you know, spread their seeds all over the greater continental US. And we did this reversal migration trip from Washington, D.C. to Jacksonville, Florida, where we scavenged for materials and then did this procession in Anacostia from Frederick Douglass's home to the opening of these storefront installations. And then again, I was done and a few months after that in 2014 on 124th Street. And we started at Marcus Garvey Park, and we crossed 124th Street. It was kind of unannounced, and just whoever happened to be by kind of participated and walked along with the procession. In the original procession, we used Jacob Lawrence's actual words, where he says on the last page, I don't remember the number of the panel, but maybe 49, where there's these people just faceless and waiting and standing, all ages together on a platform, waiting for opportunity or waiting for their train to come in to take them where they're going to go. And the last sentence of the book, it says, and the migrants kept coming. And so that was a chant that we used in multiple iterations of those processions, was that, and the migrants kept coming. This was an exhibition that was at the Peel Museum in Baltimore, which had been closed to the public since 1997, and it had many lives. It was originally constructed around 1814, and is considered to be the first building constructed to be specifically a museum here in the United States, and uncovered a lot of missing history. Well, missing to the fact that the people who are living in Baltimore now don't have any kind of recent remembrance of the role of this building and the many lives that it's played. And one being that in the 1870s through 90s, it was colored Grammar School Number 3. So it was where 600 newly emancipated students went and learned with eight teachers. it was the first City Hall building, and so then there was a procession where we collaborated with a marching band called the New Edition Marching Band in Baltimore that came and processed in front of City Hall, and this also occurred within days of the 1 year anniversary after the uprisings that happened with the murder of Freddie Gray. This is a sculpture installation that happened at the Portland Institute for Contemporary Art last fall, and it was a collaboration with an advocacy paper there for the homeless called Street Roots. It's their 20th anniversary, and they had all of this inventory in their basement and were trying to get rid of it, and I said, yes, absolutely, I wanted it. And they were also trying to think of ways where they could celebrate their 20th anniversary, and I wanted to include them in the exhibition that I was doing. So I had this idea to make this pyramid of Dozier, step pyramid of Dozier, and this was their inventory of papers that are sold only by homeless vendors. So the neighborhood, this is the backside of the pyramid, the neighborhood where I was invited was originally a black neighborhood that people were redlining to be in. I think in the 1940s, and it has been completely decimated in the last 15 years by gentrification. So people have been scattered far and wide, and Portland still has a really raging white supremacist pockets right outside of central or downtown Portland. Okay, I'm done.
See how this works. That's it. Okay. I am Leonardo Drew, and actually, specific. You know, I'm going to be talking specifically about actually the piece that's in the park at the moment. This is me in the studio, actually working on the piece. The history of this thing actually did not start off as a color monstrosity, actually. It started off as a sort of the idea of a exploding tree that was going to be something like 50-something feet tall in the center of the park. And I remember distinctly that everyone was, yes, this is going to be a great monster. It's like something, it's going to happen. It's going to, like, say, well, I said, you know what? The fact that I'm not an outdoor sculptor, it was one thing. I'm an in-studio artist. I create things in the studio, and it's like it's always about realizing the space indoors, not about taking on the whole framing of the city and the magnificence of the building surrounding. And the idea of actually making something that big had everything to do with taking on that. And it was very egocentric. And though everyone was in on the idea and wanted to see it happen, I thought, like, you know, maybe we could decapitate somebody with something as big as this. And the fact that I'm not an outdoor sculptor, I said, okay, well, how can I reasonably sort of realize a piece that said something and also probably take on the center of the park and not compromise the center of the park? So there was all these things that would challenge my philosophy. One was, okay, how dedicated are you to the idea of allowing the public? I said, if you're going to take on the center of the park, I said, maybe they should be allowed to sort of be a participant in realizing the work. And so as I stepped back and looked honestly at, okay, this is maybe an opportunity to sort of like say, if I always believed that the public was complicit, or at least the viewer was complicit in finishing the work, this would be the actual physical manifestation of that. This is me actually building a structure that would be able to support this whole idea of actually someone climbing, even though in the park right now it says you should not climb these pieces. I built these with the idea that you should climb the works. So And I don't think the kids are listening because they're climbing it. And I have videos of that. But in the end, you know, like making a piece that that would also continue to sort of change, realize itself in different iterations was important, because that's really what my work is about. And actually training the folks at Madison about, like, okay, this is not about permanence. This is actually about a work that's gonna be always in transition. People are gonna be able to walk on it, sleep on it, do whatever they want, you know, say whatever they want, they should be able to do it, you know. And the abuse was a part of the creative process. And I, you know, they should accept this, and I always sort of spiritually accepted this fact. More of the making. That's not me. But it could be, you know. So I mean, really, and creating the three different tower characters in the piece, there were stupas, there's the Empire State Building, there's Oz, there's Metropolis, all these influences from film to actual architecture to spiritual uplift, all these things are sort of built into the piece because they're all a part of how I see the world. And you can see back there one of the towers sort of laying out the piece. And here are the towers, details. The idea of a city in the grass really was, as I thought about this sort of undulating, it was gonna be an undulating wooden carpet that was gonna be a sort of like a cityscape that was influenced by actually kids that play in front of the studio in my neighborhood. And they would all stand out in front and say, that looks like the city, you know? I say, why not steal that idea? You know, why not, we say, appropriate the idea, bring it in. You know, you actually now are Gulliver, and you're standing over Lilliput. There was also the built-in safety of actually having something that's ground, you know, it's like, you know, it's ground-related and not something that's gonna be like this, it's exploding tree monstrosity that, you know, would have been a danger to the public. You know, so it's just, whenever I see this image, I mean, honestly, it's like, I built this thing in the studio, piecemeal, never really knowing what it was gonna be like in its whole self until we actually laid it out in the park. In my mind and in my spirit, I knew that there was something that was gonna happen, but I could have never prepared myself for the realization that people were going to chill and find themselves, you know, doing whatever on this piece. And when I'm walking through, it's like, wow, it's like magic, you know. I'm looking at it's like I can't help but, you know, like want to sort of like continue sort of embrace the idea of, if I were going to continue to do public art, that it would definitely be something that would be a shared experience, not one that would be about this egocentric approach to creating something that was this monumental centerpiece that would be a sculpture, outdoor sculpture, but one that would be all-inclusive. And it would allow the public to be absolutely a participant in finishing it. Maybe it's just the beginnings of something, you know. It could be beautiful, beautiful music there. And you see the Empire State Building back there. My attempt at realizing is sort of like a childish sort of realization of the Empire State Building, but it ain't bad. Thank you.
Do I have to click? Hello to everybody. How do I start? Sorry. Okay. So, doesn't start. When I was asked by the architect and the director of the Prado Museum in Madrid to do a ceremonial entrance, I immediately thought on a threshold between the city and the temple of the imaginary. I also thought in doing a sculpture that would include movement and time and became a public piece in itself. Four of the six bronze planes that conform the piece move six times a day, at 10 a.m. when it opens and every 2 hours until 8 p.m. when the museum closes. It creates different places within the receptacle that occupies and where the passerby can stay, thinking and observing the details of the invented vegetation that look totally abstract from afar. Deep Fontaine was conceived in 1997 when the square was designed by the Belgian architects Robert and Dime. For me, it was the first time I had to confront my work with issues of urbanism and city needs and constraints. Can a piece of art stop people passing by and look longer? Could I use the pavement to the edge? I studied how long people stay in the museum and worked with the construction of time. Maybe the piece was different when they come out. The sculpture is like a pond by the stairs of the museum. It has a cut, an abyss at the bottom that appears to go down deep. The water stirs, appearing and disappearing, veiling and unveiling the invented vegetation in concrete that forms the basin. The sequence goes from being full, still, forming a mirror, to the total emptiness like a drained lake. It is about the time of looking and the detail. The building of Renzo Piano in Santander connects the old part of the city with the sea, tunneling the main road that enters into the city. All this area was long time ago part of the sea. My work consists of five constructions between the city and the sea. Each of them envisions an underground marine garden with a patinated stainless steel seaweed-like vegetation. As you walk the central path, you encounter a well with a tidal movement of water. Three triangular ones draw the limits of the plaza below the building, creating places to stay and wait. Water moves inside the wells in a sequence of different intensities and flows that lead into one pond tilted towards the sea from where the staircase starts up to the entrance of the building. The abstract bas-relief in the pond reminds us like the sand when the seawater retrieves. Forgotten Streams works as a gap, as a moat, defending the building by Foster and Partners for Bloomberg headquarters in London from possible aggressions, and at the same time constructs a gathering place in the middle of the financial district in London. It is also about memory, the memory of the Walbrook River connected to the Thames. I wanted to make people aware of the possible phreatic zones, natural water reservoirs, life under the pavements and buildings in our cities. The passerby passes running from the tube station to the office and back, seeing maybe a glance of the piece and listening to the sound of it. I wanted to think that sometimes they would look more slowly, waiting for something to happen again. The piece is composed by three parts, two on the west and one in the east of the building. The layers of apparent roots, mud, and other signs of vegetation in patinated bronze look as if continuing under the pavement, under the building, connecting both sides, so as the old passage the building has recuperated to. It is very interesting
how private grounds can be gained for public use. It is remarkable that this building has affected the fluidity in that part of the city. I believe art pieces can transform the use of places and make us think. The water again moves at different paces, showing that life continues also at night. Toledo is a natural fortress, a rock surrounded by a river. Tres Aguas conforms a new route in this historical city where three different cultures live for three centuries together. The walk between the three sites is also part of the piece and the experience. The tower at the Fábrica de Armas, the springs there consist in going up the outside stairs of a reconstructed Mudéjar tower, looking from the top to the river and the city and down inside the tower through an opening at the original water containers. Going down by the constructed staircase into the empty tower with its digged bottom forming a big vase casted in stainless steel with abstract forms that recall the bottom of a river. The sound of it all forms part of the experience. Out of the tower, we cross the Jewish quarter, the synagogue of La Blanca, arriving to the plaza of the town hall and the cathedral that was once a mosque. A river that appears and disappears cut it in the pavement. The water flows down in its inclination for a while along a channel at the bottom. Then it empties. After a while, the water comes backwards, as if coming from the real river to fill the shallow vase completely. We can feel the slowness of it all. When it's full, the town hall and the cathedral get reflected in its waters. After we walk towards the upper part of the city, we can always get lost in between and find all the traces and treasures of history. In a quiet white room in the convent of Santa Clara, at the highest point in the city, a cut in the floor appears at the end of the staircase. Again, the movement of the water and slow timing involved in the observation of the detail brings back the memory of what you have already seen. It all, the piece, recalls the multiple strata that forms the city geologically and culturally. In the island of Espiritu Santo by the city of La Paz in Baja California Sur, Mexico, I could work with marine biologists that are connected with different programs of protection of the seas. The idea was to create a work that could be a symbol of the creation of marine reserves there and worldwide. Imagining the depths of that fertile sea as a vast public space, I did a construction in two sides that form a kind of labyrinth. The screened walls construct spaces and are formed by a text that talks about the Atlantis as a Platonic idea that connects continents and acts as a memory bank of the ocean floor. The text draws openings, providing the necessary gaps where all creatures are living. The island of Santa Clara in San Sebastian is a rock, a public space, the remote in the city. The journey to go there is also part of the piece. The piece will transform only the interior of the lighthouse and shines every night. The moment you enter there, you find a void going down towards the sea and a passerelle going up to a balcony to observe. The big bronze vase with strata that will help to form the illusion of a bigger depth connects mentally with the sea. The composition of movement and time with the water and the sound of it conforms the experience. I am now working on this project that we'd open in 2020. Thank you.
Thank you all for joining us this morning, and to the extraordinary participants, Holland Cotter, our moderator, Max Hohlein, and Fairleigh Baez, Alex DeCorte, to the presentation in conversation, Todd Williams, Billy Chen, and Martin Purrier, and to the very extraordinary presentations, Stefan Akin, Christina Iglesias, Abigail DeVille, and Leonardo. It has been a wonderful morning, and I think that we've discussed the endless boundaries and opportunities and issues in public art. Thank you all for being here.